your Bible out. And once your Bible is out, I want you to turn it to Numbers chapter 21. And I'm actually going to do part two of a message that I preached a long time ago that I didn't know I was doing part two of this until the Lord told me to do part two of this. So I was asking the Lord, as I was praying for you and asking the Lord specifically what he wanted you to hear, he kept taking me to this passage. I didn't know why he kept taking me to this passage. So I was in the bathroom a few minutes ago, and I was like, Lord, what do you want them to hear? And he told me to tell you these words: I am here to help. So if you are a note-taking person or you need a sermon title is very simple: I'm here to help. Not me, but the Lord is here to help. I'm going to read one verse in chapter 21 of Numbers, and then I'm going to pray, and then we're going to sift back through this passage and several other passages to contextualize the text for us. Is that cool? Awesome. This is the word of the Lord in Numbers chapter 21. The Bible says in verse 34, "The Lord said to Moses, 'Do not be afraid of him, for I have already delivered him into your hands, along with his entire army and his land. Do to him what you did to Sihon, king of the Amorites, who reigned in Heshbon.'" Verse 35, so I'm reading two verses. "So they struck him down together with his sons and his entire army, leaving them no survivors, and they then took possession of their land." Father, in Jesus' name, would you help us as we read this passage to understand that you are here to help. You are not seeking to hurt us. You are always here to help. I pray that you would use the things in my story that will help us to understand this. I pray you speak a word and answer the question that has been nagging somebody in this room, like a splinter in their mind, like Morpheus said. They are continuing to come to you with the same question. Pray that you would answer that tonight. I pray you would say things that people have said in the privacy of their closets, bedrooms, bathrooms, kitchens, basements. Would you speak in such a way that they would have to know that they've heard from you? Would you let it be known that you're God, that I am your servant, and I'm saying all these things according to your word and not my own? In Jesus' name, amen. So, this is what I want to do. First, I want to contextualize this passage for you because I think that's helpful, so you can know exactly what's happening and why I only read that part. And then from contextualizing the passage for you, we're going to sift back through this text. Can I do that? So I can't remember when. I think it might have been either last semester or the semester before. I came in, I preached from Numbers 21. Shoot, it might have been 3 years ago. I don't remember. What I do remember is we talked about the bronze serpent when I was here before. And so this is on the heels of the bronze serpent. It's right after that. But you've got to know all of the different things that happened. I remember specifically standing in this spot and talking about how when the people complained, so many bad things had already happened. So here's point number one that you need to hear. Point number one is growing grief. Growing grief. Here's what happens. So in chapter 20, in the first month of the whole Israelite community arriving at the desert of Zin, they stayed at Kadesh. Miriam died and was buried. Miriam was Moses' sister. And so here's the first thing: Miriam dies. As you look down the passage, what ends up happening is verse 2, there was no water for the community there, and the people began to gather in opposition against Moses and Aaron. So these people are triggered again because there's another place where they have no water, which has happened to them before. So Miriam's dead. They're triggered. As they're triggered, God tells Moses to speak to the rock. Moses, in his anger, the Bible says, verse 11, he raised his arm and he struck the rock twice with his staff. Water gushed out, and the community and their livestock drank. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, "Because you did not trust in me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the Israelites, you will not bring this community into the land I have given them." So Miriam died. God gave them a direct command. They have no water. God gave Moses a direct command. He disobeys the command, and then Moses is prevented from going into the promised land. God tells him at that moment, "You won't go in." So for 40 years, Moses has delivered the people of Israel. He's walked around the wilderness. He's heard about the promised land. They've talked about the promised land. He makes this one decision, and God says, "Nope, you're not going to get to see the promised land anymore." That happens. Then the next thing that happens, if you look at verse 22 of chapter 20, the whole Israelite community set out from Kadesh and came to Mount Hor. At Mount Hor, near the border of Edom, the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, "Aaron will be gathered to his people. He will not enter the land that I'm giving him because you both rebelled against my command at the waters of Meribah." So what ends up happening is Moses takes Aaron up on top of the mountain, and then Aaron dies. Aaron is Moses' brother. So the reason I'm contextualizing this for you is I want you to think about this from Moses' perspective. Not just Moses, but the people of Israel. You have been wandering through the wilderness for 40 years. You are on the precipice of moving into the promised land, but you hit this place where there's no water. One of your matriarchs dies. One of your patriarchs dies. If you're Moses, this is your sister and your brother that have died. Now God has told you, you're not going to go into the place that you have longed for. So the dream that you've had for 40 years is a dream that now will not be fulfilled, all because of your own disobedience. When you talk about growing grief, these are the things that they are dealing with. Beyond that, then, verse 1 of chapter 21, when the Canaanite king of Arad, who lived in the Negev, heard that Israel was coming along the road to Atharim, he attacked the Israelites and captured some of them. Then Israel made this vow to the Lord and said, if you will deliver these people into our hands, we will totally destroy their cities. The Lord listened to Israel's plea and gave the Canaanites over to them. They completely destroyed them and their towns. So the name of the place was Hormah. So not only are people dying that are close to Moses, they get attacked in the midst of that by these foreign people that they don't even know just because they're walking on the road, right? After that happens, verse 4, they traveled from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea, but the people grew impatient on their journey. They spoke against God and against Moses, saying, why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in this wilderness? There's no bread, there's no water, and we detest this miserable food. If there's no bread and no water, I don't know what you mean by we detest this food, because that would mean there's some food, right? So they again start grumbling. God then sends these snakes to bite them. If you know this story, anyone who gets bitten by the snake then dies. So if you're following me, Miriam dies, Aaron dies, Moses is told by God he can't go into the promised land. They get jumped by some people. Those people didn't capture some of their people. They didn't have to go fight these people. Then they continue to walk through the wilderness. And as they walk through the wilderness, people grumble and complain because they're just tired. They're just sick and tired of the fight. They're sick and tired of the journey. They're sick and tired of walking around in the wilderness. Now, all of you are looking at me. So now can I give you what you're waiting for? Can I give you what you're waiting for? Because all of y'all are like, how does this apply to me? So some of you, some of us are looking at the election, and we're looking at next semester, and we're looking at midterm grades, and we're looking at all of these things that are growing grief. We have lost loved ones. There are people that we have, that we thought were our friends, that have revealed themselves as not being our friends, and we're going through all of that stuff right now. We have been emotionally jumped by some people that we thought we could trust. Like, stuff like that has happened. The people that you thought were rolling with you are now not rolling with you, a lot like what you see here. And so as that grief grows, if we're going to be honest, some of us have made some really poor decisions because we're like, okay, God, I was doing this for you, at least so I thought I was doing this for you, and now it seems like you don't care. Like, my family's dying. They're, like, it doesn't seem like things are going the way that I think that they should be going. So just like for Moses, grief has grown, for a lot of us, grief has grown, and we're just tired along the journey just like they were. So we complain against God and we complain against the body. Some of us, can I just be real with y'all? Right? When you see Christians act the way Christians have acted over the last 2 weeks, I would say more than that. But specifically, when you talk about things like the election, and now people are looking at the potential for World War III and all of these other things, and people are looking at finances, there are so many people that are scared to death of what is coming next. And there are people who think that America and Israel and America and the church are the same, and they're not. They're nowhere close to the same. They're not the same. They're not even kin to each other. The reason that that's important for you to know is because as we look at this passage and you understand growing grief, Moses made a poor decision to strike the rock, and then God says, you're not going into the promised land. He still, though, is commissioned to lead the people. So I want you to get that in your mind's eye. This dude for 40 years has been leading these people. From 430 years of slavery, he was the one that was their deliverer. And now the very place he wants to go, he can't go because of one opportunity of disobedience. Not only that, there were 603,550 men, able-bodied men that came out of Egypt. And when they went to spy out the promised land and they spotted out, there were men that went. Of the men that went, God said only two of them would be allowed to see the promised land, and the rest of that generation would die. That means 603,550 people, just males, died. Now, we don't know who else died, but we know that in that 40 years, those 600,000 people died. I think we did the math one day at the office just for the fun of it, and it's like crazy. It's like 1,500 people a day are dying, which, again, people go, oh, yeah, that happens in Pittsburgh. Like, that's not a big deal. It is when all of those people are in your community, right? Like, if all of these people are people that are family members and people that you know and people that you interact day to day, and you're just watching them drop like flies every single day, Like, that's what we're talking about. So all of these people, the Bible says, are weary from their journey. And so that's why they're complaining. That's why they're grumbling. That's why they're becoming impatient. And that's why they're making these poor decisions. God sends these bronze serpents to bite them. They bite them. But God tells Moses to make a serpent, set it on a pole. And the Bible says when anyone would look at it, they would be rescued. Verse 10, they move on and they camp in a different place. I'm going to skip all the way down to verse 21. Verse 21 says, as they were going on their way, Israel sent messengers to say to Sihon, king of the Amorites, let us pass through your country. We will not turn aside to any of your fields or your vineyards. We will not drink water from any of your wells. We will travel alongside the king's highway until we have passed through your territory. But their king, Sihon, would not allow Israel to pass through his territory. Instead, he mustered his entire army and he marched out into the wilderness against Israel. Again, they have been through so much already. I don't know how many of y'all ever feel like this. So I have a son with diabetes that got diagnosed in 2020 in the midst of everything. I had a son in 2017 who went to the hospital and was in a coma for 90 days with intractable epilepsy. He went from healthy as any of us in here to now nonverbal, does not walk, does not talk. We take care of him every single day. He's fed through what is called a GJ tube now, and we carry him everywhere he goes. He's in a wheelchair. It makes life very challenging and difficult, right? On top of that, then, my wife just found out she has high blood pressure because all of these things are happening, right? So I have Graves' disease in my family. My mom, I think, has it, and then my older brother has it. We just took my 14-year-old daughter to the doctor, and the doctor wants to check out her thyroid and do ultrasound to make sure that her thyroid is intact. If you know what Graves' disease is, it's your thyroid either being hyperactive or hypoactive, right? So I'm like, man, we already got all of these issues going on. Like, look, we don't need another thing. Am I making sense? I don't know if y'all have ever been there where just so much is mounting. Just understand, these people are trying to peacefully just go about their business, and they tell somebody, look, we want to do is just walk around your territory. We're not going to touch any of your stuff. We just going to walk around your territory. And they letting them know they do that. They're not trying to sneak, right? And this king, instead of just saying, yep, you can do it, says, I'm going to fight you. Instead, not only does he say no, but the Bible says he mounted up an entire army and marched out into the wilderness to fight against Israel. Growing grief is point number one. Point number two is an arrogant army. I'm going to do my best to not be emotional and yet at the same time try to be really practical for you. I don't know how many of you find yourselves here, but you're trying to do the right thing. You're trying to make the right decision, and evil just keeps coming your way. Like, you're trying to have integrity and people still not treating you the right way. Right? You've done it the wrong way before, but this time you're like, no, I'm actually going to speak up and tell the truth. I'm actually going to do the right thing. And it seems like it's worse off for you than when you did the wrong thing. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Right? Like, they are trying to do the right thing and offer peace and say, we're not going to touch your stuff. Just let us pass through. And war comes along because this army says, no, we're not letting you pass through our stuff. Well, this is what happens. The Bible says in verse 24, Israel, however, put him to the sword and took over his land from the Arnon to the Jabbok, but only as far as the Ammonites because their border was fortified. Israel captured all of their cities and they occupied them, including Heshbon and all its surrounding settlements. Heshbon was the city of Sihon, the king of the Amorites, who had fought against the former king of Moab and had taken from him all his land and as far as the Arnon. If you're the person going, what does that mean to me? None of that matters. What you need to know is, when Deuteronomy happens, the word Deuteronomy means second law. And before they go into the promised land, Moses lays out all that God has done for them. Now, Moses could have started with the story of the Red Sea, but you know what Moses starts with? Moses, it's not that he doesn't talk about the Red Sea, but he talks about the Red Sea, and then he doesn't go and talk about the Amalekites. He doesn't go talk about all the other wars they fought. He starts with this one. Now, I find that to be interesting as I read through Deuteronomy. If you go read Deuteronomy chapter 2, he specifically mentions this one. And as you look at the history of Israel, they keep going back to this one. And I'm like, yo, why did they keep going back to this one out of all of the other wars that they fought? In fact, if you look back even to chapter 20, the Edomites did the same thing. The Edomites said, you can't come through here either. But they didn't fight them because God told them that they couldn't. I'm like, God, why do you keep going back to this war or these wars? Because the next thing that happens, I'm going to answer that question in a second. Verse 27, that's why the poets say, come to Heshbon and let it be rebuilt. Let Sion's city be restored. Fire went out from Heshbon, a blaze from the city of Sion. It consumed Ar of Moab, the citizens of Arnon's heights. Woe to you, Moab. You are destroyed people of Chemosh. He has given up his sons as fugitives and his daughters as captives to Sihon, king of the Amorites. In other words, Sihon was a power that went and destroyed all of these people. And so to destroy Sihon as a power is a big deal. I don't know if y'all grew up in a neighborhood like I did, right? Where if you get into a fight, naturally then they got to fight your older brother, right? And then they got to, you just got to keep fighting until you get somebody's daddy or you get somebody, you know what I mean? Like you just keep fighting until you fought that one. That you're like, once you beat them, you kind of go, oh yeah, y'all family won. But it might take 5-10 fights. Everybody know what I'm talking about? When they beat Sihon, the next thing that happens is Israel is settling where the Amorites settle. Verse 32, after Moses had sent spies to Jezer, the Israelites captured its surrounding settlements and drove out the Amorites who were there. Then they turned and went up along the road toward Bashan, and Og, king of Bashan, and his whole army marched out to meet them in battle. So constantly, all these people are trying to do, listen carefully, is get to the place where God told them they're supposed to be. I'll say that again. They're just trying to get to the place where God told them to be. And every time, they're met with opposition. Now, I don't know if you are like I am. Whenever I'm pursuing something God wants me to pursue, I'm just going to be real. Sometimes when I meet opposition, I'm like, I thought I was doing what the Lord wanted me to do. Like, I thought the whole point was I'm doing what God wanted me to do. Why is this so hard? Why is there opposition at every turn? Understand, they are doing exactly what God told them to do, and every single place that they turn, they are meeting opposition. If you don't hear anything else I say tonight, you need to hear this. Satan is never happy when you're pursuing God's will and has to get in your way. So if you are the person saying, man, I'm trying to do what God told me to do. I'm trying to do the right thing. There's opposition everywhere. My foot has almost not slipped. In other words, I'm ready to give up and quit and just do the wrong thing because there's too much opposition. I don't even know if this is what the Lord wants from me because look at everything coming against me in the midst of it. Can I tell y'all something that I've learned as a believer? The reason this army is so arrogant is because this army is actually coming against God, not just God's people. And I need you to hear that. If you are in relationship with Jesus, you've asked Jesus to save you. Satan ain't just coming against you. He's coming against Jesus. Y'all know how in Lion King, when they go to the elephant graveyard and they're not supposed to, and Shinzi and Banzai and Ed are like taunting them. And then you see little old Simba try to roar at them, and they just laugh at him, right? The first time he roars. But then the second time he roars, when he roars, you don't just, like, you don't hear his roar at all. You hear Mufasa's roar. And then they all get scared because Mufasa comes and waxes everybody. Y'all know what I'm saying? That is what it looks like when we pray, and we actually are allowing the Lord to live through us. The reason I'm saying that that's so significant is, everywhere they turn, there is an arrogant army seeking to derail them from exactly where God wants them to be. And I'm assuming he's doing the same with you, which is why you have been so frustrated. I don't know who I'm talking to right now. I know that when I looked at this passage, I was like, Lord, this seems confusing to me. But when he started unveiling this, he started saying this, faith is facing the fierceness of the battle while not knowing the outcome, but being fully conscious of your inability to succeed or move forward without divine help. I'm going to say that one more time, and I'm going to give you the third point. So growing grief, all of these bad things had happened. Bad things continued to happen. There was an arrogant army, not just one, but several that kept coming against them. But God brought divine deliverance. I'm going to say this again. Faith is facing the fierceness of the battle while not knowing the outcome, but being fully conscious of your inability to succeed or move forward without divine help. This is what we don't do enough. I think when we read these stories, we go, well, of course they beat that army. I just want to remind you, Miriam died, Aaron died, 603,550 people had died. I don't know how many people died with these snakes biting them. I don't know how much time this took, but we just act like ain't nobody grieving, everybody just cool with everything. No, like the reality is these people are living everyday life and still having to fight a battle every time they turn around. And I don't think they're the only ones. I think there are people in this room, you going through the same thing. You're trying to do the right thing, and you find yourself getting all kind of resistance. It's like, yo, but I'm trying to do the right thing. Fact is, some of you, when you were doing the wrong thing, got way less resistance from your parents, peers, all kinds of people. When you was out there tripping, nobody was really bothering you. Like I tell people all the time, when you lost and you're sitting on the couch playing a video game, Satan ain't asking you if you actually know Jesus. Because he know you does, you don't, right? But once you come to know Jesus, you can just be walking down the street and then come these thoughts. Like, do you actually know him? Look how you just looked at her. Or look at what you just did. Are you sure you know him? That's how Satan works. Because in his arrogance, what he wants you to do is falter every single time. He's going to bring as much opposition as he possibly can. I just need us to know that there are two types of opposition. One opposition comes because we are on the path to do what God called us to do and the enemy wants to stop us. Another type of opposition is the opposition that Moses encounters in not going to the promised land because of his own disobedience. Now, I'm just here to tell you, some of us need to check that one too. We need to see, Lord, have I actually continued to pursue you, or have I made a skinny path next to the narrow path and I'm saying I'm pursuing you, but actually if I asked you, you wouldn't agree. Divine deliverance, as they come along and they march out, the Lord said to Moses, this is so cool to me, because in this passage, when they first get attacked at the beginning of chapter 21, they go to the Lord and say, if you will deliver them into our hands. But by the end of chapter 21, the Lord is coming to them and saying, hey, I got you. It is always amazing to me that when the Lord says, do not be afraid, I'm going, is this a preemptive, preventative, do not be afraid because they haven't hit the fear point yet? Or is he having the conversation because fear has already crept up? I just want to remind you, they just finished fighting. Like, if you don't read this story, if you read the story like, yeah, all this happened, I just want you to get this in your mind's eye, like it's legit. Y'all know what I'm talking about? World War I, World War II. Y'all know what I'm talking about? When you talk about a time, we don't know how long this took. What we do know is it had to be in the span of at most a year, because they had been in the wilderness for 40 years and they were getting ready to go into the promised land. So this got to be in year 40 that all of these battles are happening. And each battle might take 3, 4, 5 weeks. But I just want you to think about this. Let's say that the battle with these people of Eric takes 3, 4, 5 weeks. No wonder then people who are traveling from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea get tired because of the journey. Yo, we just finished fighting people. Miriam dead. Aaron dead. We've watched other people die. We out here in the wilderness. Dang, like something needs to change. I thought we were on the right track. I thought we were doing what God wanted us to do. How is this so hard? It ain't just hard a little bit. It's like hard all the time. The one thing that I've learned is if you're going to pursue Jesus, you are going to be made like him. And the Bible says of him that he was a man of sorrows, acquainted with suffering. If that's not what you want, you don't want the Jesus of the Bible. If you don't want to understand what it means to have grief, somebody once will say that grief is love with no place to go. If you don't want to know what that's like, you don't want to know Jesus of the Bible. If you don't want to know what it's like to be abandoned, if you don't want to know what it's like to be rejected and despised by people, esteemed by people as if God doesn't like you, which is what the Bible says about Jesus. Like people said, no, God is doing this because you are doing the wrong thing about Jesus, the Son of God, the Messiah, who never sinned. That's what people said. If you don't want that kind of life, it ain't the God of the Bible you want. But this text says, God approaches them, verse 34, do not be afraid of him. Listen carefully. I have already delivered him into your hands. Now, can I just be real with y'all from my perspective? I'm a sometimes a cynic when I look at the scriptures. I'm just going to be real. Can I be real? When I hear this, right, I just want to remind you, Moses sent spies. They went up the road. The king of Bashan and his whole army marched out to meet them in battle. And then the Lord says, hey, I've already delivered them. Now, wait a minute. We ain't fought yet. Y'all understand what I'm saying? Like, there's been no fight yet. There's no scrapping yet. There's no swords drawn. Ain't nobody dead yet. And God is already saying, look, I already took care of it. That's easy to say, right? And it's easy to hear. But here's the thing I think we forget. This text says, so they struck him down. This text does not say, so then God sent this big thing of wind and he just kind of vacuumed everybody up and they didn't have to fight at all. That ain't what the text says, right? The text says that they struck them down. So even though God says, I've already delivered them, they still have to go fight this battle. And they still have to go wax them, right? They still have to go annihilate these people. And the text says that they left no survivors, but they still had to go and do that. All of their grief-stricken life, all of the things that they'd had encountered, they're pulling all of that into this too. And sometimes when we read the scriptures, we act like all of these people had no issues and just loved God no matter what. No, I think the reason he says do not be afraid is because Moses already knows he's not going into the promised land. He knows people just died with the bronze serpent. He knows that people died with Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. He knows that 603,550 people have already died. He knows a lot of people in the army are gone. They just fought a battle. I don't know that everybody lived. I have no clue. What I'm here to tell you is Moses is staring at an army coming down the hill at him. And God says, don't be afraid. I've already taken care of it. So you got a school bill to pay. And the days to pay that are getting shorter and shorter and shorter. Everybody understand what I'm saying? You've got decisions to make about where you're going to live. And the days are getting shorter and shorter and shorter. I've got money to raise right before this year ends to make sure our staff gets paid. And the days are getting shorter and shorter and shorter. Those of you who are raising money, I heard you earlier. The names on the list, you're starting to run out of names. Everybody understand what I'm saying? When that happens, faith is facing the fierceness of the battle while not knowing the outcome, but being fully conscious of your inability to see to move forward without divine help. It is saying, God, there's no way I'm getting beyond this without you doing something. And the Lord says, I've already delivered him along with his entire army and his land. Do to him what you did to Sihon, king of the Amorites, who reigned in Heshbon. So they struck him down together with his sons and his whole army, leaving them no survivors, and they took possession of the land. I just need you to know that that text is letting us know that God is here to help. There are some of us that turn to him, and we are using him like a lucky rabbit's foot or a vending machine. It's like I made the deposits with my Cheetos, shaking him like he's a machine trying to get the Cheetos, right? When in reality, that's not how God works. So I'm going to read this to you. This is Deuteronomy chapter 2. He says, we turned back and we set out toward the wilderness along the route of the Red Sea as the Lord had directed us. For a long time, we made our way around the hill country of Seir. Then the Lord said to me, you have made your way long way around, long enough. Turn toward the north. Give the people these orders. You are about to pass through the territory of your relatives, the descendants of Esau, who live in Mount Seir. They will be afraid of you, but be very careful. Do not provoke them to war, for I will not give you any of their land, not even enough to put your foot on. I have given Esau the hill country. You are to pay them in silver for the food you eat and for the water you drink. The Lord your God has blessed you in all the work of your hands. He has watched over your journey through this vast wilderness. Wait. You did what? Man, we had no water. Miriam died. Aaron died. What do you mean you watched over it? Anybody ever felt like that? This text says, these 40 years, the Lord your God has been with you, and you have not lacked anything. Do you remember the story when he was waiting for you? Like, what do you mean you haven't lacked anything? Is the scripture lying? No, what the scripture is saying is the outcome that you did not see, right? Because water did come from the rock. They just didn't have water to listen when they wanted it. Say that again. God brought water from the rock, but they didn't have it when they wanted it. He brought it in his time, and so he did take care of them. They did not lack a thing. But they wanted God on their agenda instead of them wanting to be on God's. Verse 9, the Lord said to me, do not harass the Moabites or provoke them to war. I will not give you any of their stuff. Drop down to verse 14. 38 years passed from the time we left Kadesh Barnea until we crossed the Zered Valley. But then that generation of fighting men had perished from the camp. That's the 603,000 had died. As the Lord had sworn to them, the Lord's hand was against them until he had completely eliminated them from the camp. Now, when the last of these fighting men among the people had died, the Lord said to me, today you are to pass by the region of Moab at Ar. That's the story we read. Fam, when the last one died, then the Lord said, all right, let's go. Wait a minute. We just lost the last of them. Like, our army just got smaller. And now you're telling us to go fight these people that are bigger, stronger, greater, and more numerous than us? Exactly what he did. The text says in verse 20, that too was considered a land of the Raphites who used to live there, but the Ammonites called them the Zumanites. They were a people who were strong and numerous, as tall as the Anakites. The Lord destroyed them before the Ammonites, who drove them out and settled in their place. The Lord had done the same for the descendants of Esau. Verse 23, and as far as the Avites who lived in villages as far as Gaza, the Kaphtorites coming out from Kaphtor destroyed them and settled in their place. Verse 24, set out now and cross the Arnon Gorge. See, I have given into your hand Sihon the Amorite, king of Heshbon, and his country. Begin to take possession of it and engage him in battle. This very day I will begin to put the terror and fear of you on all the nations under heaven. They will hear reports of you and will tremble and be in anguish because of you. Folks, if that doesn't mean anything to you because you're losing the context, the story that we're reading, these are the things that we didn't hear in that story, that at that time, God is saying, look, the last one's dead. You're a very small army. I'm sending you to people greater and bigger and stronger than you, and I've already given you the land. So, fam, you don't have to be worried about what you're going to do next. Faith is facing it, having no clue what the outcome is going to be, but you are fully conscious that you can't move forward without divine help. In other words, God is saying, yo, I'm here to help. And so when you look at these stories, one of the stories that God starts with, chapter 2, chapter 3 in Deuteronomy, the second law, before they go into the promised land, where Moses is reminding them of what God has done, is simply to say this to them. Hey, there are nations that are bigger, straighter, greater, stronger, and mightier than you. And every single one of them God took care of for you. Don't you dare get into the promised land and then all of a sudden act like it's on you. If you're doing the math, what Moses is saying is, when we were at our smallest, that's when God had us fight the largest numbers of people, and he built a history of help with us, where we now know it ain't about us, and it was never about our army anyway. So for you, God has done tons of things already that if you're not careful to write them down and look back at what God has done, you're going to think it's about you and on you to do whatever is next. When it's not on you, it's on him. By his grace, you stand straight up, point blank, period. Can I go a little further? It might sound mean to some, but let me just go a little further. I would tell you, America is not the church. We want to legislate righteousness. When we talk about, no, that ain't what it's about. If the church stands up and is who she's supposed to be, half of this foolishness will be cut out. But the reason it's not cut out is because the church wants the government to do something that the church is supposed to do. He already set us here for it. We're afraid to get persecuted. We're afraid to speak up for what is right and righteousness. And we're acting like Jesus has to be involved in the U.S. Constitution. He doesn't. It's not his job. Jesus didn't come here going, let's reform Rome, y'all. Let's take all of this stuff. And no, he came here preaching the kingdom of God, freedom for captives, healing the brokenhearted, taking care of the orphan and the widow. And all of us often are in school going, what job am I going to have so I can do the American thing and fulfill the American dream, which I now call the American nightmare. Not because I don't love America, but because a love for America for many has caused the love of God to wax cold. Now it's more about what I can get from instead of what I can give to. The Lord says, man, I'm here to help, but you're not letting me help you. What you're trying to do is get it for yourself and on your own. And he's like, no, the whole point of me doing this and throwing all of this opposition at you is so you can understand you cannot do it on your own. And once you recognize that, the humility should go, yeah, of course we need your divine help. Lord, would you please help us? Would you please do something for us we cannot do for ourselves? Instead of us saying, no, we're going to pull ourselves up by our own bootstraps and we're going to make this happen. The reason this passage has been so convicting to me, y'all said I can be real with y'all yet? Folks, I'm in Christian ministry. It is my job to preach the gospel. Like, it's my job to go in my office and pray that God would provide the funds and provide the students. It's my job to pray that God would move on your heart to come work on our staff. That's my job. If I'm going to be real, though, sometimes I fall into the same traps as any other business recruiter. How do I get them to come and work here? What do I need to say to get them to come and work here? What would make them excited about coming and work here, right? If I'm not careful when I'm in an interview with somebody, I remind myself to often say, and I'm going to say it to you now, do not come to City Kids if God doesn't want you at City Kids. But if God wants you at City Kids, let nothing stop you. But if God doesn't want you at City Kids, don't come. I will often be fundraising. We actually had a dinner. Now I'm telling stories. We had a dinner in September. Fam, can I just be real with y'all? Yes? We had a dinner in September. At that dinner, I never once asked for money. We had a dinner in a room full of people who were, many of them, very wealthy. We never once asked for money. What we did is we said, go home, or before you leave this room, bow your head, and for 5 seconds, just say, Lord, every resource I have belongs to you. How would you have me interact with City Kids? That's all we're asking you to do. And then I'd love to hear from you what God said. That's what I told him, right? Because everything in me was like, yo, this is the time you ask for money right here. Like, you in a room full of people who could write, one of them could write a check, you never have to raise money again. I was at another event for a person who used to work for one of our presidents, and I got asked to speak at this event, so I go and I speak at this event. It's at a golf outing. I'm speaking at this event. I finish speaking. I leave the podium. When the event's done, this lady runs up to me and she goes, this ain't even my event, y'all. Ain't even my event. Not even my thing, right? Because I do City Kids. I was doing something else for a scholars program. This lady runs up to me and she's like, you're inspiring. I'm giving $20,000. And I'm like, yo, where was you last week when I was at this thing? I needed somebody to do that then. And the Lord immediately was like, bro, this ain't about you. This ain't about you. Never was. Never will be. But I think some of us in this room want it to be about us. And God's like, no, no, no. This has always been my story. See, when we talk about the growing grief, the people are not just growing grief. God is also grieved by these people who don't trust him. There's not just this arrogant army that's fighting against his people, but there's an arrogant army that God has raised up that he wanted to fight for him, and we're fighting against each other. But there's a church on every single corner, and we can't seem to agree. Shoot, campus ministries can't agree and spend time together. Sometimes, anyway, leave that alone before I get in trouble. And then when we talk about divine deliverance, often we forget that Jesus said it's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. You're sitting here begging God for stuff like he's not a good daddy, like he don't love you. Can you imagine? Like, I got 8 kids, right? If any kid come up to me and go, Daddy, will you please feed me? Will you please feed me? Can I just have a peanut butter jelly sandwich? What's wrong with you? What is wrong with you? I'm your father. Of course you can have a peanut. Of course I'm going to feed you. Right? I don't know about you. I do that to God all the time. Talk to him like he's not a good daddy, like he ain't got my best interest in mind. Talk to him like he don't already know what's going on. I don't know if you like that, but I definitely do that all the time. Doing it on the road, on the way here. I'm convicted at this moment, if I'm going to be honest with you. God knows what you're going through. But just know, sometimes he allows that opposition. Because real talk, if there was no opposition, you might not trust him. If there was nothing, right? If he provided those needs that you are constantly in his face for right now, if it was already managed for you, if it was already there, you might not talk to him. If he already provided you the opportunity that you've been praying for, longing for, he's already done that thing, you might talk to him less. So sometimes, listen, this is crazy. Sometimes God in his grace is going to keep that thing from you because he knows that thing keeps you from him. And you're looking at God like he's mean? No. What he's doing is going, no, once you chase that though, you're going to only chase that thing and it actually has no place to satisfy you. And I'm keeping you from that disappointment and hurt. I'm keeping you from that shame. Let me be real with you. If you keep chasing it, he has no problem going, read Deuteronomy 28. He has no problem going, all right, you want to chase it, chase it. But when you search for me with all of your heart, you can return. But just know, sometimes the way that he disciplines you is he goes, all right, hey, you can have it. Go ahead. So, dang it. I think this is the last story. And I posted this on Instagram recently. So, 2-3 days ago, something like that. My daughter Haven, who is 2, just going to contextualize because she 2. So, understand the context. She 2. She don't know no better, right? I put her in the van. I'm going to put her in her car seat, and she stands up in her car seat. Like she, I'm going to tell y'all the whole story. You know, Instagram, I'm trying to keep it short. Tell y'all the whole story. She stands up in her car seat, and I'm like, yeah, babe, we're going to leave. Like, you need to sit down, and you need to get buckled. And so as I start sitting her down, she's like fighting me to stand up in her car seat. And I'm like, yo, we need to go, right? So I put her bottom down in her car seat. She starts crying and flailing and kicking her feet. And I'm like, babe, I'm not trying to hurt you. I'm trying to buckle you in. Like, I'm just trying to strap You in, so that you're safe when we drive on the road. Right? And so she kicking and screaming. We finally give her a pass. I think she's tired. I don't know what's going on. All I know is she kicking and screaming when I'm trying to buckle the girl in so she can be safe. What if I'd have given in to her cries and pleas? What if I'd have said, all right, you want to stand up in the back of the car seat? We're going to drive this 15-passenger van right up the road, and we're going like 15 miles. You can stand up in your car seat if you want to. Like, that girl is going to end up on her head somewhere cracked, and she's going to have to go to the hospital because it's not safe for her. Right? She thinks that the restraints that I'm putting around her are to hurt her or to restrain her or to keep her from something. And it does. It keeps her from getting her head cracked open. She doesn't know because she's two. Immediately, as I'm buckling her in, I'm saying the words, babe, this is to keep you safe. This is not to hurt. I'm here to help you. Dang it, Lord, I'm sorry. Because when you start bringing the restraints for me, what are you doing? Why are you restraining? I'm here to help you, man. This is your seatbelt. And I'm taking you on a journey. I'm taking you on a ride that you don't know where you're going. You haven't been this way before. It's going to be a little bumpy. It's going to be a little hilly. And I need to make sure you buckled in by my word to make sure that we can get to your destination as safely as possible with you unscathed. Don't think that just because God is buckling you up, he's buckling you down. Understand that when he's buckling you up, he's trying to keep you safe. Father, in Jesus' name, would you help us to know that that's who you are, that's your MO. That's what you're doing, that you're here to help. And there are some of us in this room that are looking at your law and calling it stupid because we want to do some things that your law says not to do, and we don't even understand why you made that a law. There are some of us in this room right now that, if we're to be honest, we see you buckling us up in relation to the word, in relation to who you are, in relation to opposition even. You're taking us up these hilly, bumpy roads where there's opposition everywhere. We're trying to do the right thing, and we're constantly met with resistance. We don't understand it, and we've been frustrated with you, complaining like they did in chapter 21 before you brought those snakes. There are some of us, Lord, just like chapter 21, that are just weary from the journey because we've just fought so hard and not seen the progress to the promised land that we know that you've promised, but we haven't seen it yet. We haven't experienced it yet. Right now, it just feels like you're dragging us along in the wilderness. We know you know good. We know you know what you're doing. We know that you're a good father, but it just hurts. We know that it's making us more like Jesus, but it hurts. Thank you for reminding us tonight that you're here to help. There's no way we can move forward without your divine help, your divine guidance. So God, I pray that I would lean and rest on you. For any person in this room that resonated with what they heard tonight, that we would lean and rest on you, recognizing what, when the arrogant army of the enemy comes against us, that's because we're on the right track and we're moving toward the destiny you have for us. Help us then to trust you to deliver in your timing and not ours. Give us patience and the power to endure without complaining until then. In Jesus' name.